Everybody, we'll start the speech. Spectrum of neurofibromatosis.
Good afternoon, esteemed judges and dear friends. My motto of my presentation is to make everyone aware of a pre-existing Jackson and Lee's classification for neurofibromatosis, which is a very common condition encountered in daily practice. We are all aware that neurofibromatosis is an autosomal dominant disorder with an incidence of approximately 1 in 3,000 births. That is, we encounter neurofibromatosis cases in our day-to-day practice. The patient may develop grossly disfiguring neurofibromas of the orbital, temporal, and facial region. Neurofibromas come under the category of hamartomas, and they consist of Schwann cells, nerve fibers, and fibroblasts. There is the unique thing about neurofibromatous infiltrated tissues is that they are very vascular with wide open capillaries which bleed copiously during surgeries, and they are neither circumscribed nor encapsulated. So the signs can vary from a simple subcutaneous swelling to a classical skeletal abnormality involving the absence of greater wing of sphenoid, which can be partial or complete, to a pulsatile proptosis, which is due to a meningoencephalocele or a total temporal lobe herniating into the orbit. Our purview is intraorbital neurofibromas, which is causes in eventual bony enlargement with hypoplasia of the supraorbital and infraorbital rims, zygomatous hypoplasia, and orbital 4 depression. Now, Jackson et al. Has already classified orbital neurofibromas way back in 1994, but not many of us are aware of such a classification. He has classified the orbital part with a condition of the eye. He classified it into orbital soft tissue involvement with a seeing eye, orbital soft tissue plus a bony involvement with a seeing eye, and an orbital soft tissue involvement with bony involvement with a blind eye. So few clinical examples of the same. So orbital soft tissue involvement with a seeing eye, an obvious sphenoid dysplasia with a seeing eye, and a sphenoid wing dysplasia with a blind eye. When Jackson has classified the orbital part of neurofibromatosis, Lee has classified the periorbital and palpebral aspects of the disease as brotosis, upper lid infiltration, lower lid infiltration, lateral canthal disinsertion, conjunctival and lacrimal gland infiltration. But classically, we don't encounter these strict forms into our day-to-day practice. So some clinical examples are here. Lower lid infiltration. So why? What is the motto of my presentation? Because the management of orbitotemporal neurofibromatosis is quite challenging. It often requires a multidisciplinary approach by an oculoplastic surgeon, a plastic surgeon, plus or minus a max fac surgeon. So classification. If we are aware of such a classification as the above, it helps in a tailored surgical treatment according to the severity of the condition, and we can give a better outcome to the patients. These are my references. Thank you for attention.
Now I invite the next speaker, Dr. Athira Devaraja. Devaraja? Then Dr. Apurva. She's not there. Dr. Ashok Kumar Grover. No. Dr. Dipankar Das. Arvind Tenagi. Okay, Dr. Neetu Kumari. She'll be speaking on histopathological profile of a case of rhabdomyosarcoma.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am going to discuss on a histopathological profile of a case of rhabdomyosarcoma. A 1-year, 6-month-old male child presented to our hospital with the chief complaints of protrusion of eyeball in downward and outward direction since 4 months, which was rapidly progressive in nature. There was no history of pain. So on examination, dull reflex noted in the right eye, bright reflex with central, steady, and maintained visual acuity noted in the left eye. On fundus examination with indirect ophthalmoscopy in left eye, it was within normal limits. MRI and CT scan of orbit, it revealed a large extracorneal retrobulbar mass in the right orbit with marked proptosis with no invasion to the orbital wall, as we could see in this picture. So the provisional diagnosis of orbital rhabdomyosarcoma made, and the patient was advised and underwent orbital biopsy plus debulking under general anesthesia. And the specimen was sent for the histopathological report. On hematoxylin and eosin stain, there was a presence of rhabdomyoblast with eccentric nucleus and bright eosinophilic cytoplasm, as we could see in these two slides. And this is the cell type, which is a histological feature that defines rhabdomyosarcoma at the morphologic level. Also, there was a presence of elongated to round spindle cells. Also, there was a presence of elongated to round spindle cells with highly eosinophilic cytoplasm and hyperchromatic nuclei. There was a dense condensation of rhabdomyoblast, which is surrounded with a loose myxoid stroma. There was a clustered and cohesive pattern of cells was seen, which suggested malignancy. Also, immunohistochemical staining was done, which was highly positive for vimentin, desmin, and mildly positive for actin. It was negative for CD45, which had excluded other hematopoietic malignancy. So rhabdomyosarcoma, it is the most common soft tissue sarcoma of the head and neck in childhood. 10% of all cases occur in the orbit, and the peak age of presentation is at 5 to 7 years. It originates from pluripotent mesenchymal cells that has the ability to differentiate into a skeletal muscle. Histologically, there are 4 types of rhabdomyosarcoma. These are embryonal, leiomorphic, alveolar. Embryonal constitutes majority of rhabdomyosarcoma, which has a favorable prognosis. Bordery white seems to be a variant of the embryonal type, which assumes a papillary configuration. Leiomorphic, it is exclusively seen in the adults. And alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma, it has a worst prognosis. Immunohistochemical markers which is present in the rhabdomyosarcoma are antibodies against desmin, which is seen in 90% of rhabdomyosarcoma, muscle-specific actin, myod1, and myoglobin. Vimentin and desmin, they are usually positive, but they are less specific. Thank you.
Hello. It was a nice presentation. What all can you do otherwise in rhabdomyosarcoma? You have done desmin and myod1. Any other stain which you could have done more specific?
Myoglobin, actin and desmin we had already done. And also we can see on trichrome stain.
Any special stain that you can do which brings out the muscle striations?
Myod1.
Special
myoglobin.
Stain, not an immunohistochemical stain. A PTH will be helpful to bring out the muscle striations.
Okay. What was your differential in that case? Means it was what you thought of initially when you saw the patient?
Ma'am, it can be a case of mostly ocular tumor only. So it can be a case of neurofibroma, we can think. We can also think of retinoblastoma, since it can invade to the metastasis may be there. Then
retinoblastoma, when you thought, did you rule out by immunohistochemistry? You have done only LCA apart from desmin.
Marker. We had ruled out.
No, what was the stain that you did for retinoblastoma to rule out it?
Ma'am, retinoblastoma we had ruled out clinically, basically.
Achha. Because all of them are malignant small round cell tumors. So you have to actually rule out using a panel of immunohistochemical stains.
No, not immunohistochemical. We had ruled out clinically and on MRI and CT scans.
Then no intraocular tumor, that's no basically.
Thank you, Dr. Neetu. I'll be calling upon next Dr. Manju Shri for her presentation on rhino-orbital mucormycosis.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be presenting a case report on rhino-orbital mucormycosis. Rhino-orbital mucormycosis is a rare but life-threatening infection that generally occurs in patients with diabetes mellitus and other immune deficiency conditions. It is of two forms, rhino-orbital and rhino-cerebral forms. Early recognition and treatment are essential as the mortality rate is 30 to 70%. A patient, 39-year-old male, presented to ophthal OPD with sudden loss of vision and ptosis of right eyelid since 3 days. Patient was also a case of uncontrolled diabetes mellitus. On right eye examination, visual acuity was negative for a perception of light. There was presence of complete ptosis. Corneal sensations were absent and pupil was 7 mm fixed, non-reactive to both direct and indirect light reflex, and complete ophthalmoplegia was present. Posterior segment examination revealed established papilledema, signs of cerebral retinal artery occlusion. However, there was no diabetic retinopathy changes. On nasal endoscopy, black crusting was present in the nasal cavity and the turbinates and nasal mucosa were atrophied. Nasal mucosal biopsy revealed colonies of fungi with two different morphologies suggestive of aspergillosis and mucormycosis. And the CT scan showed right maxillary, ethmoidal, sphenoidal, and frontal sinusitis. The patient was managed with intravitreous liposomal amphotericin B for 21 days, and he was also underwent a functional endoscopy sinus surgery with right orbital decompression with local infiltration of amphotericin B. Mucormycosis is a condition with fulminant course and a high mortality risk, with diabetes mellitus being the most common predisposing factor. The early diagnosis and treatment of mucormycosis is very important in terms of prognosis. Treatment within 6 days have a survival rate of 76 to 81%. However, a treatment delay of more than 12 days reduces the survival rate to 36 to 42%. The prognosis of mucormycosis has markedly improved over the past 30 years with a 90% survival rate. Amphotericin B has become the gold standard in the systemic treatment of mucormycosis. Before the use of amphotericin B, the survival rate of mucormycosis patient was about 6%. After the introduction of amphotericin B, this rate has drastically increased to 60%. As mucormycosis forms vascular obstruction, it may be difficult for drugs to reach the affected area. Therefore, local infiltration of infected area with amphotericin B is used in conjunction with surgery and systemic therapy. To conclude, mucormycosis remains a severe infection disease in diabetic patients and it is characterized by a high mortality rate. It should be underlined that in diabetics, vigilance to the infections within the facial skeleton is of utmost importance. The survival rate is increased and the need for exenteration can be avoided with endoscopic debridement, systemic and local infiltration of amphotericin B and aggressive control of underlying risk factors. Thank you.
Did he recover only along with the 21 days of liposomal amphotericin?
Yes, ma'am. Up to 3 months.
Completely.
Up to the ptosis and the other ophthalmic signs did not regress. Our main aim was to prevent the cerebral spread. So we wanted the patient to survive.
Why you didn't go for serum posconazole? This is the latest one, latest antifungal which has come.
Okay.
So that is more effective than liposomal amphotericin. So along with, if you start serum posconazole, they show a greater, means good recovery along with both this therapy.
Okay, thank you.
Usually this occurs in people using steroid inhalers.
Sorry,
steroid inhalers for immunocompromised patients. Appreciate Dr. Sinha.
Thank you, Dr. Manjushree. Nicely presented a case of young patient presenting with mucormycosis, a young diabetic patient. I would now call upon Dr. Reshma for her presentation on orbito-ocular neoplasms and bizarre presentations.
Good afternoon, all. I'll be discussing a few rare cases of orbito-ocular neoplasms presented to our department in the period of January 2018 to 2019. As we all know, these tumors are very rare, and of the rare cases reported, majority were of orbital malignancies, many were of aggressive behavior, and the management involves a multidisciplinary team effort. Of the conjunctival neoplasms, acquired hypermelanosis stands first, and the least common was squamous cell carcinoma. This is a case of a 75-year-old lady with 1 month history, and she was a hypertensive. She presented with a conjunctival mass with indistinct borders with limbal involvement, and MRI showed a prominent perineural hyperintensity suggestive of inflammation, and the treatment was with excision cryotherapy followed by chemo radiation. Of the limbal neoplasias, limbal dermoids stand first, and this is a case of a 8-year-old girl presenting with a lipodermoid. We can see the pre-auricular tags. This is a case of a Goldenhaar syndrome. Of the uveal tract tumors, iris nevus was common, and this is a uveal masquerade presenting from ovarian carcinoma in a 21-year-old girl. Of the intraocular tumors, retinoblastoma was the commonest. Of the lid and adnexal neoplasms, benign nevus stood first, and the least common was the lacrimal gland adenocarcinoma. Of the orbital neoplasms, orbital lymphoma, pseudolymphoma, rhabdomyosarcoma, vascular tumors were common. And this is a 45-year-old lady with a sudden onset of inferiorly displaced proptosis. This was a frontal mucosal, and it was treated by endonasal frontal mucosal resection. This is a post-op picture. This is a 66-year-old woman with a 1 year history of a huge right eye mass. The mass measured approximately 13 × 12 × 8. And it became fragile and started bleeding over the course of time. This is a soft tissue mass in the MRI film, and it showed infrotemporal and retroorbital extension. Histopath showed a small round cell tumor, and IHC showed CD99 and 45 positivity with desmin and chromogranin negativity suggestive of a PNET. Multidrug chemotherapy was started. This is the second day after the first chemo. This is the 21st day after first chemo. This is after second chemo, this is after third chemo, and this is 1 week after third chemo, this is after fourth chemo. See the drastic reduction of the size. This is an 80-year-old male with a pedunculated mass of right upper eyelid, and differential diagnosis was sebaceous cell carcinoma and squamous cell carcinoma. CCT showed heterogeneous enhancement, and it was treated by excision. Histopath showed marginal involvement also, and this is a post-op picture after 7 days. This is a case of a 50-year-old lady with adenoid cystic carcinoma treated by surgical excision and radiotherapy. This is a case of a hemangioma in a 24-year-old lady, and this is a case of an embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma recurrence. They didn't continue the chemotherapy as advised, so the tumor actually recurred. This was treated by enucleation and en-bloc excision, and chemotherapy was restarted. This is a case of a cavernous sinus syndrome in a 45-year-old lady. MRI showed extraaxial dural base mass lesion involving the cavernous sinus. And this is a 46-year-old female with a lacrimal gland lymphoma. And this is a case of a 70-year-old lady with a squamous cell carcinoma of the lid, and which was moderately differentiated in a HP report. Thank you.
I think you got too short of time and you were running around with these slides. I think she was worried of finishing it in time.
So like lots of cases were there, and actually I didn't know.
So the second last patient which you had shown with sebaceous cell carcinoma, what was the treatment you gave to the patient?
It was excised, and temporary tarsography was done, and after that chemotherapy was started.
You did not think of neoadjuvant chemotherapy?
Actually, this patient didn't turn up on follow-up. We saw the patient only 1 week after, and then we referred to him to the oncology department. So after that, we couldn't collect the data of the patient.
Okay. You want to ask something?
Which is a dangerous area if it starts?
Sorry, sir?
Which spreads fast. Usually in the fornix, in the carunculus, it goes inside the orbit. Starts in the, those are dangerous parts.
Thank you, Dr. Reshma. I'll be calling upon Dr. Nishchala B for her presentation on dual therapy in a refractory case of cavernous hemangioma of the orbit.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Nischala, and today I'll be presenting a case of dual therapy in a refractory case of cavernous hemangioma of the orbit. My patient was a 19-year-old girl who presented with a swelling of the right upper lid since 9 years. The swelling was initially small in size, about 2x2 cm, and this was gradually progressive. There were no associated features like pain, redness of the swelling, fever, or loss of weight. There were no secondary changes like ulceration or fungation. There was no history of any other swellings anywhere in the body, and there was mild grade mechanical ptosis in the right eye. The anterior segment examination was normal. The vision was 6-9 in the right eye and 6-6 in the left eye. It was normal except for the anterior segment examination of the lid of the right eye, which showed a diffuse swelling, which was 5x4 cm when we examined the case. On inspection, it extended from the right upper lid crease to the right pupil. There was moderate to severe grade mechanical ptosis. The size was diffuse and it was measuring about 5x4 cm. The skin over the swelling was slightly bluish in color and the surface appeared smooth. There were no dilated vessels or engorged veins and there were no pulsations observed. On palpation, it confirmed this, the findings of inspection, and the transillumination test was negative. The shape was slightly oblate and it was soft. And the margins, it was well defined, but there were no attachments to the surrounding structures, and there were no signs of inflammation. It was partially reducible, compressible, fluctuant, and non-pulsatile, and the skin was pinchable. This is the CT scan showing the mass in the right eye upper lid, and in the anterolateral aspect of the orbital cavity, minimally extending into the lacrimal fossa. It was suggestive of either a lymphangioma or a cavernous hemangioma of the orbit. The histopathology confirmed that this was a benign vascular lesion, which was probably cavernous hemangioma because of the cystically dilated vessels with thin walled flattened epithelium, and the lumen also showed intravascular thrombosis and hemorrhage. She received 2 doses of intralesional sclerosin therapy, 1 ml of sodium tetradecyl sulfate, over a period of 1 year, that was in January 2018 and August 2018. She responded well to the treatment, and there was a reduction in the size of the swelling and ptosis which was observed. She returned in Jan 2019 with slight increase in the size of the swelling since a month. This residual mass was excised surgically using an argon diode excimer laser with the help of an oromaxillary facial surgeon. These were the masses noticed initially when she first came. In August, it slightly reduced after the first dose of intralesional sclerosin therapy. The lid and the ptosis improved, and also the size of the swelling decreased drastically after both the doses. And this was the on-table appearance just before surgical excision. You can also see that the incision used, and the last picture showing the argon excimer diode laser in use. And this was the first post-operative day picture. We gave her lots of Tolpa D and serratiopeptidases, which actually decrease the edema. In conclusion, I would just like to say that intralesional sclerosing therapy was used to downsize the size of the tumor, and the argon excimer laser was used to control bleeding. So both these together actually decreased the need for for surgery, and this could help similar patients in the future. Thank you.
Clinically, it's looking like lymphangioma. You can send these slides again for review.
Okay.
And most of the time, cavernous hemangioma is easy to excise it completely.
Yes.
Because it is a well encapsulated lesion. With the cryo probe, it comes easily. So if the patient has responded to sclerotherapy, so must send the slides for review again. It's not looking like cavernous hemangioma.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
For capillary, you have dual. Rarely only you have used dual for
cavernous. One more question. You consider the differential as lymphangioma and cavernous, and histologically you got it as cavernous.
Cavernous.
So how will you differentiate between lymphangioma and cavernous hemangioma histologically?
First of all, we saw that the endothelium was like, and there was hemorrhage and thrombosis noticed in
hemorrhage you will get in lymphangioma also.
No, ma'am.
You'll get lymphoid nodules in the stroma, which you don't get it in cavernous hemangioma. You may have hemorrhage in lymphangioma also, but the lymphoid nodules in the stroma give away the diagnosis, and they are thin-walled as compared to what you get in cavernous hemangioma.
Thank you.
Okay, Dr. Partha Pratim Roy. He will be speaking on hidradenoma of eyelid, a rare case report.
Good afternoon. Today I am here to present a case of hidradenoma of right lower lid. So my patient is a 50-year-old woman presented to our institute with an enlarging, painless nodular mass in the right lower lid that began 6 months prior with rapid increase in size over the last 3 months. The mass became significantly prominent over the last 1 month. Physical examination revealed a solitary mass in the middle third of the right lower lid, overhanging the lid margin that was of size 30x30x20 mm. The mass was underlying the right lower lid skin, extending beyond the lash line without invading the palpable conjunctiva. It was firm to hard in consistency and tender to touch, and did not appear to extend deeper underlying tissues. There were no regional lymphadenopathies. The other ocular and general physical examination were normal. So we thought it may be a case of basal cell carcinoma or squamous cell carcinoma. Then biopsy was sent to pathology service. These are the pre-op measurements of the tumor. Then we planned for a surgical intervention. So a complete wide excision of the nodular mass with a 3 mm clear margin of the healthy surrounding tissue was performed, along with lid reconstruction was done using tensile flap technique. This is the tensile flap we have done. Then the patient was followed up. This is the first post-op picture, day one picture, then day seven. These are the excised mass measurements. This is the histological slides. It revealed the outer surface was lobulated. These are loosely clustered cells arranged in a glandular manner in a mucoid background, suggestive of some benign admixture. Cut surface showing multiple, these are the whitish areas in the third slides. So the appearance it shows features of atypical clear cell hidradenoma. So in discussion part, hidradenoma is a cutaneous neoplasm that can occur at various sites. It has been referred to as clear cell hidradenoma or eccrine sweat gland adenoma. It is also known as nodular hidradenoma or clear cell hidradenomas. Clinically, usually it presents as a solitary interdermal nodule which is well circumscribed and may appear encapsulated. Clinical diagnosis is difficult at best, and we believe any lesion which shows evidence of enlargement should be warrants histological evaluation. The differential diagnosis may be any primary skin tumors with follicular, sebaceous, or sweat gland differentiation. Hydronymus can mimic cutaneous metastatic disease from clear cell tumors such as renal cell carcinoma also. So, conclusion, I am concluding hydronymus are distinctly unusual and extremely rare in the eyelids. The possibility of sweat gland tumors should be considered in the differential diagnosis of eyelid tumors to ensure early detection. Management involves complete excision of the lesion. Thank you.
It was a good presentation. Did you suspect malignancy beforehand?
Yeah.
Before going for surgery?
Yeah. Initially, we are suspecting malignancy because due to the rapid growth of the tumor since the prior 6 months, last 3 months it was growing rapidly. So initially, we are suspecting it to be a malignant tumor.
Which?
We thought either basal cell carcinoma or sebaceous cell carcinoma.
You've taken proper care for the margins, taken extra margin?
Yeah, we have taken 3 mm clear margins.
How much was the width of the lid was involved?
It was middle third.
No, it appeared almost 50%. And it appears to be 50% of the lid was
involved. Yeah, 50%.
And less than one third the tensile flap is done. It appears to be cheek rotation flap.
No, sir.
Quite height, almost it gone up to the auricular area.
Yeah, it was extended till, but not up to tragus.
Because you have done a wide excision.
Yeah, so yeah, we have done a wide excision.
It appears that it was a cheek rotation, not tensile flap.
So we've done lateral canthotomy. By doing lateral canthotomy only we mobilize the flap. Yeah.
Frozen section was requested, like this.
Frozen section was not available at the time, madam, in our institute.
Yeah, we wait for half an hour. Once the report comes, the margins are free of tumor, then we should go ahead with the lid reconstruction.
Yes.
So I think it should be available in all the hospitals. Almost available in all the government and private setup also.
Yeah, at that time it was not available in our institute.
Because if margins are not free of tumor, then chances of recurrence is very high.
Yeah.
So you can repair the next day or 2 days later once the pathologist gives the report. That way it's better, because if the margins come positive, then you're not going to open it again.
Actually, they put a cellophane tape. Wait for 2 days till our results come. In foreign countries, within half an hour, they'll get the frozen second result and they will do the resection.
Okay.
For basal 1 millimeter like that.
Everywhere it is half an hour, you get the report, the pathology report. You have to just do, it's always better to, inform, give a prior information and then you can do a frozen section guide.
So actually how we do it is that we also don't have a big setup and we don't have a frozen section in our hospital. But we have a tie-up, so we inform the pathologist, send the specimen, and he gives the report on phone, and we carry on with the surgery.
Yes.
So this can be done, actually.
Thank you, sir.
Next, we'll be presenting Dr. Ashok Kumar Meena. He'll be presenting on varicose carcinoma, a rare variant of squamous cell carcinoma.
Varicose carcinoma, a rare variant of squamous cell carcinoma. No financial disclosure. Varicose carcinoma is a rare and indolent variant of a squamous cell carcinoma described by Ackerman in 1948, characterized by a very slow growth progressive pattern that is more expansive than invasive and have a good cellular differentiation. Occur most commonly in oral cavity and larynx. It's more common in elderly male. I am presenting the case report. 85-year-old male farmer presented on weight November 2016 with a painless mass in a left interpalpable region, first noticed 12 months back. No history of ocular trauma. Positive history of smoking is there. Visual acuity at present is PL positive and PR inaccurate. On examination, there is a gelignitis lesion was noted covering 270 degree of the parallel central cornea and the adjacent conjunctiva. The patient received topical mitomycin and 7 day on and 7 day off regime for we have given four cycle were completed and topical loteprid catiflox administration were given and the side of the mass has been reduced. There is a reduced congestion, vascularization is also there. After completing the 2 months, we have mass excision done with amniotic membrane transplantation has been done. There were a catet was present and histology report has been came. On the histology report, there is a hyperkeratotic acanthic squamous epithelium with a papillomatous eczematic moderate atypia and the diagnosis came with a varicose tumor of the conjunctiva, which is a very rare variant of the, because it is mostly common in the oral cavity and the larynx. After 8 months of this amniotic membrane transplant, we have done a cataract surgery and the patient got vision 6/18 and it's continue maintained after a 2 year follow. Thank you. These are the photo pictures, how we do and final outcome of this. Thank you.
Interferon was considered for this patient?
Yeah.
Interferon was considered?
No, actually the interferon is expensive and the patient is
a huge lesion and is overlying the cornea. So basically is a corneal involvement is more.
Yeah.
Compared to conjunctiva. So in this type of scenario, we should go ahead with the chemo reduction followed by excision.
Yeah.
So it gives a better result compared to the plain excision.
That's why we have given initially mitomycin C cycle has been given. 8 cycle after then the size has been reduced. We have wait for 6 months, then only we have done the excision with amniotic membrane transplant. And for cataract surgery, we have wait for 8 months.
Next. It's a rare case of giant conjunctival nevus and its management. Dr. Swati Deshpande.
Good afternoon. I'll be presenting a case of giant conjunctival nevus and its management. Giant conjunctival nevus is a congenital melanocytic lesion present at birth that will reach a diameter of more than 20 centimeters till adulthood. It is a benign proliferation of melanocytic cells, which are also known as nevus cells, arranged in nests. Its incidence is 1 in 20,000 newborns. Generally, it presents as a brown lesion with flat or mammillated surface and is recognized as a risk factor for the development of melanoma. Here we describe a case of giant conjunctival nevus presented in a 19-year-old female with suspicious clinico-morphological appearance. The lesion was noticed by parents in childhood as a hyperpigmented spot on the bulbar conjunctiva of left eye. The lesion was initially small with the size of a pea and has gradually increased in size. On slit lamp examination, a large conjunctival lesion with variegate pigmentation and indistinct margins was detected on the bulbar conjunctiva of left eye. The size was approximately measured to be 12 mm into 8 mm. Detailed ophthalmological examination was performed. Visual acuity was 6/6 in both eyes with normal fundus. Management, observation or wide excisional biopsy, cryotherapy and reconstruction with or without graft can be considered. Alternatively, it's a surgical removal with or without graft. In this case, we have performed a wide excision with amniotic membrane grafting, which was used to restore the ocular surface under local anesthesia, since the patient was concerned more on the cosmetic approach. Histopathological examination of the biopsy revealed compound type of conjunctival nevus with no signs of malignancy. Differential diagnosis includes malignant melanoma or pseudopterygium. Discussion, Jain conjunctival nevi represent a rare melanocytic conjunctival alteration. Considering the extended conjunctival involvement and variegated clinico-morphological appearance, these lesions can cause differential diagnostic difficulties as they can be confused with malignant melanoma. During follow-up examinations, alterations in the vascular network can be visualized and compared in various segmentation levels. Concluding, it is the Jain conjunctival nevus is a rare entity. Precise diagnosis and adequate management are very important as it can be confused with malignant melanoma. Thank you.
If you have cystic spaces and if you don't have cystic spaces?
Yes, sir.
Cystic spaces means you may be benign, but if it's
yes,
solid.
Sir, it
and
can be benign, sir.
Solid, it will be, you have to think
yes,
otherwise.
Sir, it's malignant, sir.
If there is a feeder vessel also, you have to
yes,
think
sir.
Otherwise.
Vessels. Thank you.
Dr. Manpreet, please. She'll be presenting on fibrous, benign fibrous histiocytoma of the orbit. Next, I would request Dr. Athira Devraj to be ready. He can come in front, wherever he is. Dr. Athira is there? Okay, so then Dr. Jyoti Dhaka is there. Next is yours.
Okay, good afternoon. I will be presenting on benign fibrous histiocytoma of the orbit, a case report. So, fibrous histiocytomas are a heterogeneous group of mesenchymal tumors that vary considerably in their morphological features and biological behavior. Some investigators consider them to be of histiocytic origin, and some consider them to originate from a primitive mesenchymal cell. They are classified histologically as benign, locally aggressive, and malignant. And they constitute 1% of the orbital tumors and the commonest primary mesenchymal tumors of the orbit in adults. Rarely, they can involve conjunctiva, perilimbal area, or lids. And fibrous histiocytoma with orbital involvement was first described by O'Brien and Stout in 1964. The signs and symptoms could be presence of a lump, proptosis, diplopia, pain, decreased vision, restricted ocular movements, swelling of the lids, and conjunctiva. So I will be presenting the case of a 19-year-old male who presented with the complaints of a slow-growing mass in the inner aspect of the upper eyelid below the eyebrow for the last 9 months. It was a painless mass and there was occasional pain or deep pressure. There was no history of fever, weight loss, trauma, previous surgery or radiotherapy. On local examination, there was a firm, non-tender, relatively immobile mass in the superior nasal quadrant of the superficial orbit. It was oval in shape, approximately 10 × 6 mm in size, not tethered to the skin. Posterior borders were not defined. Visual acuity was 6x6 in both eyes. Pressures were normal. Fundus was normal. Extraocular movements were full. And there was no regional lymphadenopathy. The CT scan revealed a poorly defined swelling of approximately 10 × 7 mm size with small central hyperdensity and a thick peripheral rim in the upper nasal quadrant of the right preseptal soft tissue. There was no calcification or fat, no intraorbital extension, and no bony changes. A differential diagnosis of a granulomatous swelling, oblique soft tissue mesenchymal lesion, or a chronic abscess was made on CT. The patient was further taken for MRI evaluation, which showed a swelling of 10 × 7 mm size, which was hyperintense of STIR and intermediate on T2 and T1 weighted images. There was a thin peripheral wall, no significant perilesional inflammatory changes, and differential diagnosis was again granulomatous swelling, inflamed dermoid, soft tissue mesenchymal tumor, and a chronic organized abscess. So the patient was taken for surgical excision. The incision was given directly over the skin, and we found a non-encapsulated circumscribed red to tan colored mass, approximately 10 × 7 mm in size, with well-defined borders anteriorly, but posteriorly it was blending with the periorbital tissue, relatively vascular. And excision was done after dissecting it from the surrounding tissues. The wound was closed with 6-0 Vicryl and silk, and the tissue was sent for histopathological examination. And the patient was put for oral antibiotics and NSAIDs for 5 days, and ointment local application and sutures were removed after 1 week. And histologically revealed there were combination of spindle cells that were fibroblasts and histocytes. There was no atypia and storiform pattern was evident at some places. So follow-up was regularly is done, and the patient, this is the follow-up pick after 9 months. There is no recurrence till date. So discussion, so they are the mesenchymal tumors that may be benign or malignant. Ocular involvement is infrequent and primarily limited to the orbit. And differential diagnosis can range from cavernous hemangioma to rhabdomyosarcoma. And most appropriate management is complete surgical excision. And local recurrence, orbital invasion, and metastasis typically follow incomplete excision. So to conclude, orbital fibrous histiocytomas are rare periocular tumors that can manifest multiple ocular signs and symptoms. And complete excision is advised as the recurrence rate is higher. So these are the references. Thank you.
Marker was used for diagnosing?
Ma'am, the markers were not available at the time, but they are positive for CD68, Vimentin, and factor 8A. But they were not available with the pathology department at that time.
Actually, you don't need any specific marker for benign fibrous histiocytoma, but there's a classical storiform pattern which is seen in benign fibrous histiocytoma for it to be diagnosed.
Dr. Jyoti, please. Dr. Athira is not in the hall. Okay. Dr. Praneet Telukunta, yours is next. Dr. Jyoti will be presenting on surgical treatment of unilateral congenital ptosis.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to speak on the surgical treatment of unilateral congenital ptosis, whether to operate one eye or both eyes. So as we know, blepharoptosis is defined as inferior malposition of the upper eyelid with respect to the superior corneal scleral limbus. It congenital ptosis usually presents since birth or occur within the first year of the life. It can be unilateral or bilateral. So management of severe unilateral congenital ptosis is controversial with varied opinion whether to operate one eye or the both eye. Some surgeons advocate the bilateral levator excision with bilateral frontalis sling surgery, claiming to improve symmetry. But on the other hand, this approach put the both the eyes at the risk of legophthalmos and exposure keratopathy. On the other hand, some authors advocate the excellent results with the patient who underwent the unilateral frontalis sling surgery. It gives advantage of preserving the healthy eyelid in the unilateral ptosis, and it is better accepted by the parents, and it reduces the surgical time and the risk. So we have done the prospective comparative study of 30 patients of unilateral congenital ptosis. Detailed history and examination was done. So we have divided the 30 patients into two groups. Group 1 included the patient who underwent the unilateral silicone sling surgery, and group 2 patients who underwent the contralateral levator excision with bilateral facial lata frontalis sling surgery. So post-op analysis was done at the end of 3 months in every patient, and ptosis correction was measured with the in view of MRD1, symmetry of lid height. We graded the graded excellent lid height symmetry when the lid height difference is less than 1 mm. And lid crease, lid contour, we have done the digital imaging graphy. In this, we have used the Photoshop version CS6, and the photographs were taken with the help of digital camera. We have done the multiple radial lines drawn at the every 15 degree from the limbus temporally and medially from the center of the pupil. And the analysis was done with the help of software. So lid contour in the age matched control was found to be 1.05 to 1.15. So we have taken this ratio of temporal to medial radial lines. So we have taken this TM ratio as the good lid contour. And either side of this TM ratio, 0.95 to 1.04 and 1.16 to 1.25, we have taken it as a fair lid contour. So results were assessed at the end of 3 months. We have found that the MRD1 was better in group 2 patient who underwent the bilateral facial lata surgery. And the mean improvement was also good in the patients who underwent the bilateral facial lata surgery as compared to the unilateral sling surgery. The post-op symmetry of lid height was found excellent among 11 patients, 73.3% in group 1 patient. And in group 2 patients, it was found in 93.3%. And the postoperative lid crease was found excellent in all 30 eyelids of 15 patients in group 2 patients who underwent the facial lata sling surgery as compared to 80% in group 1 patient who underwent the silicone sling surgery. So these are some few example of post-op 3 months facial lateral surgery silicone sling, and the lid contour was found to be better among group 2 patients. This is the example of TM ratio 1.10, the good lid contour. And post-operative under correction were less in group 2 patients who underwent the bilateral facial lateral surgery as compared to the group 1 patients. And we conclude that the blepharoptosis is one of the most common oculoplastic procedure. So main aim is to surgery to clear the visual field, and the secondary goal is to improve the appearance by producing the symmetrical lid height and lid crease. So we have found the in our study that MRD1 symmetry of lid height, lid crease and lid contour were excellent in group 2 patients who underwent the bilateral facial lateral surgery as compared to group 1 patient who underwent the unilateral silicone sling surgery. Thank you.
In your study you have taken 2 groups. So in one group you subjected all patients to sling,
yes,
that is silicone.
Unilateral.
Yeah, and in one group you subjected all patients to levator excision with bilateral...
contralateral levator excision we have
so
done.
So why contralateral levator excision?
So
other... Marcus-Gunn jaw winking phenomenon or something?
So
like
actually we have taken unilateral silicone sling surgery, unilateral ptosis only, ma'am. Congenital
without Marcus-Gunn jaw winking phenomenon?
No, ma'am. With also unilateral ptosis, also other
so that
eye...
That has not come in your study. So your like inclusion criteria is not completed. Okay, so you didn't mention ki whether the all these are congenital cases or aponeurotic,
no,
or all congenital cases had Marcus-Gunn jaw winking.
No, only severe unilateral congenital. Unilateral I have taken, ma'am, groups.
So because in case if the patient doesn't have Marcus-Gunn, then that patient should not be subjected to any type of levator excision. The patient doesn't have Marcus-Gunn jaw winking phenomena.
But in this we have found that, ma'am, if we do the contralateral levator excision, the other eye also we are producing the ptosis. So it will be symmetrically better in facial lateral group surgery. So we have unilateral ptosis, we have converted into bilateral ptosis, and the symmetry we have found is better as we compare to the unilateral ptosis, ma'am. Because the frontalis action is... it will give the different results, ma'am. Unilateral ptosis.
No, in one group you are doing only unilateral sling with silicone. In group two you are doing bilateral facial lateral.
Yes,
the study is not valid. Either you do facial lateral in the same eye and the sling in the other patient in the same eye and see the difference of lifting and other contour and dynamicity of the lid with silicone sling as well as with the facial lateral. In one group you are doing both eyes, in one group
idea is to whether to operate one eye or both eye in unilateral severe ptosis, ma'am.
No, no, your study should be versus silicone sling as well as with the facial lateral. Then it should be in the same eye only, in one eye only, no? In one group you are doing two eyes, in one group you are doing only some.
But we are not comparing the sling material, sir. We are comparing whether to operate one eye or both the eyes.
How did you convince the patient in which you have done contralateral LPS excision?
Yes,
normally patient doesn't allow.
Normally they don't. They will go with unilateral surgery, but we convinced symmetrically better in bilateral facial lateral. They have convinced. We have done surgeries in 15 patients. Yes, we have taken the, yes.
Nowadays
with
they
the,
say
we have taken this one, in volunteer basis only, we have taken the this one, categorized the patient in 2 groups.
Dr. Neelam Pushkar is the professor of oculoplasty is here. What is your comment, madam? See, in my practice,
Marcus-Gunn
no
also, sir, we have we do in that way.
Whatever is the patient diagnosis, in my practice, I found that facial lateral works very well.
Yes, sir.
In all cases. But sling always fails in more
yeah,
or
with
less
time over the
more
time.
With time. And the material that we are using is, we don't know whether it is a medical grade silicone is available or not. Even if it is available, it is very costly. The patient can't afford.
Yes. But this one, Dr. Grover, I've done this study under the Dr. A.K. Grover. He has done so many cases with the bilateral in unilateral patients only, sir.
Age group like of the patient?
Age group 4 to 28, I've included this. This is congenital tosoma.
So in like children who are less than 6 years, in that patient also you have?
Yes, done, after 4 years, after 4 years we have included in this study, sir. Ma'am, after 4 years we can do the this one facial lata surgery because the facial lata, it is well developed after age of 10. It is harvesting, it is difficult, but we can do with.
So I'll be calling upon Dr. Praneet for his presentation on two similar cases of incomplete Wok-Kayanagi Harada disease.
Athira Devaraj not here.
Dr. Pranami is here or not? Dr. Pranami, you're here. Okay. So you are the last speaker.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm standing here to present about two similar cases of incomplete Wok-Kayanagi Harada disease. WKS disease is a panuveitis affecting the eyes, auditory system, meninges, and the skin. In this case report, we report two cases of incomplete WKH syndrome presenting without any auditory or meningeal signs. The first case was a 55-year-old female who presented with diminution of vision in both eyes since 2 months. She also complained of multiple non-specific joint pains. The second case was a 50-year-old female who presented with diminution of vision in the left eye since 15 days. In the first case, the patient had a low vision of counting fingers of 1 meter in the right eye and counting finger of 10 centimeter in the left eye. Both the anterior segments showed poliosis, cells in the anterior chamber, and Kuiper's nodules. The ocular fundus showed vitreous cells, optic nerve hyperemia, ILM folds, localized areas of serous retinal detachment, and exudative retinal detachment in the left eye. B-scan confirmed the findings of exudative retinal detachment in the left eye and also the choroidal thickening. OCT showed subretinal fluid and serous retinal detachment. FFA showed punctate hyperfluorescence over posterior fold and staining of the optic nerve head. Similar findings were seen in the other case. Both the patients were treated similarly. They were started on prednisolone, high dose of 50 milligrams for 7 days. Then they were slowly tapered. They were also put on tablet calcium carbonate, prednisolone acetate eye drops, atropine eye drops, and azathioprine was started after 2 weeks. Follow-up after 2 weeks showed that the retinal detachment reduced and the visual acuity improved. In the case 1, it improved from counting fingers to 6-9, and in case 2 also it improved from counting fingers to around 6-36. This is the diagnostic criteria. So in this in these two cases which I have presented, they don't get into all these 5 criteria. That's why we classify them as incomplete WKH syndrome. So in our cases, ocular diagnosis of WKH was evident clinically as well as by investigations. However, there were no meningeal signs or auditory signs. In our cases, both the patients denied headache or symptoms suggestive of meningeal inflammation. They also denied any auditory symptoms. Hence, we diagnosed this patient as incomplete WKH disease. Both the cases responded well with resolution of both anterior uveitis and posterior uveitis and exudative retinal detachment with good visual recovery. Immunomodulators were stopped after 6 months of treatment. A similar study was conducted in a tertiary center in South India, which showed significant number of cases to be categorized as incomplete WKH disease. Early detection and aggressive treatment prevents the disease going into chronic stage. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor. So I'll be calling upon the last speaker, Dr. Pranami, for her presentation on atypical presentation of a case of limbal dermoid.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am here to present a case of atypical presentation of a limbal dermoid. Here is the introduction. Limbal dermoid, as you all know, limbal dermoid is the most common epialbar tumor. It's a smooth, elevated, porcelain white, yellowish round to oval lesion, and actually present in the early childhood, but rapid growth towards adulthood. Mostly asymptomatic, however, secondary complications can occur. An 18-year-old female came to our department with diminution of vision right eye since last 8 years. She had a diminution of vision since she was 10 to 11 years old and gradually aggravated since last 2 years. Just swelling in the right eye with 2 years and foreign body sensation in the right eye for last 6 months. There is no history of pain, any trauma or any other aggravating factors. There is history of associated mild redness in the upper outer part of the right eye, especially when she coming out in the sun. On examination, the BCB in the right eye 6/18 with high power cylindrical lens and BCB in the left eye normal. Right eye other intra-segment findings are normal. Only positive findings in the swelling, which is 4:2 mm oval from compressible mass located superior temporally in the bulbar conjunctiva along with the limbus involvement. Fundoscopy in the both the eyes are normal. Coming to the investigation, routine blood investigations are normal. We had done USG B scan with color Doppler right eye. Other findings are normal. Examination of the mass shows a flat, echogenic, well-defined scleral mass over the superior aspect, which measures 4 to 4.5:2 mm, and there is no abnormal vascularity and intraocular extension seen. So we have appeared a provisional diagnosis of it's a benign epialbar tumor right eye. Coming to the treatment, the patient had given conservative treatment with antibody drops and ointment with tear substitute. Later on, the patient underwent excision with 2% lignogen anesthesia and the peribulbar block. This is the excised mass. Biopsy shows focal areas of cartilage formation with little adipose tissues, secretory glands like sweat and sebaceous glands embedded in a fibrocollagenous matrix. The lining epithelium noted here is a keratinizing stratified squamous epithelium. So the fixture constitutes the dermoid. So we have appeared in a final diagnosis, say a typical presentation of limbal dermoid right eye. The points in favor of limbal dermoid, it's the most common epialbar tumor. From history also, she gave history of putrefaction as a secondary complication. It's a firm mass, smooth, though look like irregular, yellowish. Presentation in early childhood, rapid growth during adulthood. USG BIS can also constitute with dermoid. And points against the limbal dermoid, because it's not in the classical position, that is inferior temporal. Here compressibility test is also positive, and it confined mostly to the conjunctiva. And there are no hair appendages from the surface. Coming to the follow-up, she has been follow-up for 1 month. At follow-up after 1 month, a clean one is seen with mild conjunctival hyperemia, BCB after 1 month, 6/18 and 6, and no recurrence observed after 1 month. Discussion, the most common epialbar tumor, a study of Neves et al. Indicates majority 78% found in the inferior temporal region, 22% found in the superior temporal, which in our case, and article by Jae Jong, Wai Deng et al. New grading system of limbal dermoid, we can classify limbal dermoid as, we can get the limbal dermoid. The scores are cornea 0, surface shape 1, conjunctiva 3, and total score 3, so the grade is 2. These are the references. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor. We'll closing the session here. Thank you, all of you. Are the people sitting here for the next session or for the previous session? I think the next session. We are sorry for running late and asking questions and all. I think we lost track of time. Thank you.